Welcome students. Today we are going to discuss one interesting topic, that is hydronephrosis. What is hydronephrosis? By definition, it is defined as an aseptic dilatation of part or entire renal pelvic lateral system due to partial, intermittent or complete obstruction to the outflow of urine. Now it can be either a unilateral phenomenon or it can be bilateral. Causes. What are the causes for this hydronephrosis? It can be either congenital or it can be acquired. Congenital, an aberrant vessel crossing the pelvic-ureteric junction. Now, as we have already seen in the anatomy, sometimes there can be an aberrant renal artery that can actually cross at the pelvic-ureteric junction, which can give rise to compression at the PUJ, and it will eventually lead to dilatation of the pelvic lateral system. Second thing, high insertion of ureter. Now, this high insertion of ureter can sometimes lead to reflux and back pressure changes and hence into hydronephrosis. Acquired. Acquired can be various, pathological, neoplastic. So, we'll see all. Acquired commonest is stricture, which can be due to tuberculosis or to prior instrumentation or prior surgery. Commonly what we see is due to renal stones or impacted stones causing back pressure. Also seen due to tumor infiltration and some extrinsic factors such as presence of malignant lymph nodes causing localized fibrosis around the ureter can give rise to blockage and back pressure. Retroperitoneal tumors which are expanding and engulfing both the ureters, because kidney ureters are retroperitoneal structures. So there is a high chance of involvement and causing fibrosis of the ureters. And that is the other thing, that is a retroperitoneal fibrosis, which is Ormond's disease, which can be either idiopathic or it can be neoplastic. Now the pathophysiology of hydronephrosis is very interesting, because various changes occur at various stages of hydronephrotic kidney. First, we start with the functional one. Functionally, there is a change in urinary concentration. Second, there is a change in urinary pH. And lastly, there is a change in the urine excretion, that is a urea excretion actually. Hemodynamically, there is increase in the resistance and compression of vessels. Anatomically, the dilatation of the pelvic lateral system is as follows. Initially, there is a hydropelvis, followed by hydrocalcosis, followed by hydronephrosis. In other pathophysiology, what we have observed is a pressure dissipation mechanism that is usually seen in this. Now, four main things are observed in this. One is a pilotubular backflow, that is into the glomerular apparatus. The backflow is given because increased pressure and due to increased resistance. This further goes to pylointerstitial backflow. Then eventually it leads to pylolymphatic backflow and lastly pylovenous backflow. So all these different sites and different phases and different levels of backflow or back pressures eventually lead us to hydronephrosis. Now renal damage in this hydronephrosis is governed by various following factors. Commonest is the age. As the age will advance and more is the age of exposure to this particular entity, the lesser is the prognosis for this hydronephrosis. Duration. More prolonged insult is present, more damage will be present. Severity. Depending on the level, that is at the PUJ obstruction or at the uretrovesical junction obstruction, depending on the severity, the magnitude of hydronephrosis will be seen. Infection. If there is concomitant infection in the urinary tract, which can actually complicate the situation of hydronephrosis. Type of obstruction. Whether it is a part obstruction, or an intermittent obstruction, or a complete blockage, will tell how the hydronephrosis will progress. And lastly, any other comorbid factors such as presence of malignancy or other foreign bodies or any other entity in the urogenital tract. The pathophysiology continues, as we have already seen the three stages, that is the hydrocalcinosis, hydronephrosis. There are other four stages, or the pathology of hydronephrosis is observed. First is the stage of trauma or insult. Second, as it progresses, it leads to stage of muscular hypertrophy. This muscular hypertrophy, if continues, it undergoes a stage of dilatation. This stage of dilatation, if continues further for few more days, leads to actually destruction of the parenchyma and eventually to hydronephrosis. Now, what are the common symptoms or clinical features evident in this particular entity? Primary symptoms are fixed renal pain at renal angle, which is a typically dull aching pain and a continuous pain. Then sometimes in acute stages there can be colicky pain, but this is not so common. It is a relatively rare phenomenon. Recurrent episodes of burning micturition is present due to severe associated urinary tract infection. These patients may present to us with hematuria, and rarely this patient present to us with swelling in the loin, which is intermittent. Secondarily, this hydronephrosis can give rise to secondary affection and secondary symptoms such as hypertension due to pyelointerstitial or pyelotubular backflow and chronic renal failure. What are the signs that we can pick up? Primarily, one can actually detect or notice a lump at a renal angle. What we see on inspection, one can visualize fullness in the renal angle. On palpation, there will be tenderness plus presence of swelling in the renal angle, and patient will complain pain at the renal angle. So all these three things can be confirmed on palpation. But this swelling will be non-tender initially. Eventually, if it is associated with infection, it can become tender and the surface is quite smooth. Sometimes there is a special phenomenon called Dittl's crisis. In this Dittl's crisis, first described by Joseph Dittl, he mentions that the hydronephrotic kidney, the obstruction just passes off, the dilated kidney just drains the urine and gets shrunken back to normal size. Again, the level of obstruction comes. Now, this recurrent or disappearing type of lump formation is particular to this particular condition. Then, what we can notice is a high colored urine, occasionally turbid due to severe UTI that is associated. So, simple naked eye examination of the patient of urine can actually give us an inference that this patient likely to be suffering from hydronephrosis. And yes, with unexplained hypertension, patient is having unexplained hypertension, no obvious medical background, one has to think of some renal pathology. It can be either a benign cause like hydronephrosis, or it can be due to malignancy. We have secondary symptoms or pressure symptoms like edema feet. Patient can have less and less of urine. We call it as oliguria. Now, when we can mention that oliguria is present, it is when the presence or passage of urine which is more than just 400 ml over 24 hours. So, in short, any urine output in a day that is nearing 400 ml in 24 hours is considered as oliguria. Normal urine output is up to 1.5 liters for an adult human being. Uremic complications. Patient will have puffiness of face, periocular edema. These are typical of uremia, signs of uremia. Now, what investigations this entity warrants? We have to do basic biochemical investigations, that is a complete hemogram. Complete hemogram can show sometimes anemia due to prolonged parenchymal destruction. Most important is the urinary examination. Urine routine and microscopy will either show presence of albumin, presence of pus cells, presence of various casts and various gravels. Urine culture sensitivity can actually pick up various types of urinary tract infections and various microorganisms, commonest being E. coli. Renal function tests, that is the blood, urine, nitrogen and creatinine, needs to be assessed. Now, the normal limit for the creatinine is up to 1.5 mg per deciliter. So, if it increases beyond this, it means as we have already seen, there's more than 70% of the renal parenchymal destruction has occurred, and that kidney is very bad state. So it's very important that these RFTs or renal function tests need to be done and observed very meticulously. Then these patients are usually elderly, so we need to do either a fasting or a random blood sugar. If possible, fasting and porcelain blood sugar. Radiologically, what is important is one needs to do a good ultrasound of abdomen and pelvis, which can actually pick up an hydronephrotic kidney with or without dilated ureter and possibly a source of obstruction that can occur. And IVU or intravenous urography is considered to be a gold standard for this investigation. Now, I will show you a picture which will clarify a little bit more about this entity, what happens. Now, in this picture, one can see right side is a normal kidney. On the opposite side, there is a grossly enlarged or enhanced kidney. This is a normal kidney. However, this kidney has grossly dilated ureter. This is called a hydroureter or a megaureter. Megaureter is nothing but a dilated ureter which is more than 2 cm in diameter due to distal obstruction at the lower one third of the ureter, or sometimes it can be at the ureterovesical junction. So this obstruction leads to back pressure, and this back pressure leads to dilatation, and this will continue. So eventually this kidney will also get affected and will present to us with hydronephrosis. So this is obstruction lower level. Now in this opposite side, the scenario is different. Here what is happening, the obstruction is at little upper level, or we call it as the pelvic-ureteric junction obstruction. This is the zone of renal pelvis, and this is the area of kidney. So initially what happens, what we have observed is hydropelvis. Eventually it leads to hydrocalcosis. This is the area of the calyces, and eventually it leads to hydronephrosis, that is the expansion of the tumor renal capsule. Now there are certain special investigations pertinent to this entity, such as CT scan, again considered as a gold standard. It virtually replaces the intravenous urography. CT scan abdomen and pelvis will give both the anatomical as well as the physiological perspectives of this entire pathology. Then we need to do a renal angiography. This renal angiography is basically done to pick up any aberrant vessels. As we have already discussed, that crossing an aberrant renal artery over the PUJ can lead to hydronephrosis. So this angiography will give you, or give us rather, a valuable information regarding any aberrations in the vessels. Renal scan. Now this DTPA, that is a diethylene triamine pentacetic acid scan, a special isotope rhinogram scan is done to detect the viable residual renal parenchyma. It will basically give us a total clear-cut outline how much viable tissue is limited in the affected kidney, because as the pressure will go on increasing, there will be destruction of the renal parenchyma, and this destruction is going to alter the corticomedullary ratio for the kidney, and eventually the thinness will be less than 1 cm. When the thinness of the corticomedullary junction goes below 1 cm, it is considered as a critical level, and that actually carries a very bad prognosis. Means that practically that kidney becomes non-functional for the patient. So it's very important, in order to save or salvage the kidney, one should know how much percentage of the renal parenchyma or renal tissue is there. So for that, DTPA scan or renal scan is very, very valuable. What we do is a Whittaker test. Robert Whittaker first gave a mention of this test. It is nothing but an antegrade pressure perfusion test, in which a dye is injected into the pelvis, and under positive pressure, the pressure is built up into this, and it is gauged into mild, moderate or severe level of obstruction. Usually pressure below 9 millimeters of mercury is considered a mild level of hydronephrosis. Between 9 to 11 is considered equivocal, and below or above 11 millimeters of mercury is considered as a grade 3 hydronephrosis or very severe type of hydronephrosis. A simple bedside test, one can take a loin approach for doing this Whittaker test. That is, from a back approach, one can do it. Now, what are the treatment options available to us to treat this entity? There are non-surgical, versus surgical, non-surgical or little bit conservative approaches are like balloon dilatation. One can use 24 French size balloons, just pass across the level of obstruction, dilate it momentarily for 1 minute, deflate it and come back. It is like performing an angioplasty. But we have to be very careful to select the site, because sometimes this retained stone or some pathology actually erodes and weakens that particular junction. So if you have not chosen the site of valvulation correctly, it can actually lead to rupture of the ureter and cause further problem than the original problem. So it's very important that you select the site carefully and judge it that whether this patient is suitable for doing a dilatation. Then endopilotomy, that is the endoscopic approach. It can be done either in a retrograde manner or it can be done in an anterograde manner for the patient. These are the conservative approach. Then the minimal access surgery can be done. Now what are the options available to us? One can do laparoscopic or keyhole surgery, that is a laparoscopic pyloplasty. Nowadays, urologists attempt this particular approach. Second approach, this laparoscopic is transabdominal approach. Second is a retroperitoneoscopic pyloplasty. This particular approach is done from the backside, that is the retroperitoneal approach or extraperitoneal approach. And last is a robotic pyloplasty. This robotic pyloplasty is still in a stage of infancy in our country, but it is the near future in which robots will operate and will perform the corrective measures for this pyloplasty. Nowadays, the robotic surgery is limited basically to oncosurgery. Surgical approaches, that is the last option to these treatments. What are the options do we have? Surgically, there are two main types of pyloplasties that we do. One is a dismembered pyloplasty versus non-dismembered pyloplasty. Now, what do you mean or what do you understand by dismembered pyloplasty? Dismembered pyloplasty is the affected junction, affected PUJ is actually separated, refashioned and reunited. That is called as dismembered pyloplasty. The gold standard or operation for years for this particular entity is Anderson-Heinz pyloplasty. I will just show you pictorially how we go about it. Now here there are two situations. This is a pelvic uterine junction obstruction which is an acute angle. So what we need to do, this is a typically funnel shaped pelvis. Okay, this funnel shaped pelvis is what is usually normally seen, but here due to the blockage it is momentarily dilated. So is this correct? No. What will happen? There will be momentary change and the pelvis will be box shaped. Okay, because of the hydropelvic state. Now because of the hydropelvic state, there will be a lot of reflux. So what you want? We want to change this box shaped pelvis into a funnel shaped for easy facilitating of the drainage. This pictorial diagram will show you what exactly we do in Anderson-Heinz surgery. In Anderson-Heinz pyloplasty, this is a typically diseased kidney in which there is a block at the pelvic-ureteric junction. Because of this block, the pelvis, which should be funnel-shaped normally, has become a box-shaped because of the increased pressure. There is no drainage. Now, our aim is to convert this box-shaped pelvis into a normal funnel-shaped pelvis. This is non-redundant pelvis. We have to make it redundant. It is proper facilitating drainage. So what we do here is actually we remove this particular portion. We dismember it. That's called dismembered pyloplasty. And this portion of the ureter is again open like this. And now these two portions are united. So eventually it leads to this. That is, a box is converted into a funnel. There is an easy drainage facilitated. And again it is united over a wide junction. The junction is widened. So it fulfills the criteria for ideal pyloplasty. That is why Anderson-Heinz is considered as an ideal pyloplasty. And in non-dismembered, what we do, we don't actually remove the portion of the pelvis, but what we do is in continuation, we just modify and reposition or reconfigure the renal pelvis and achieve the pyloplasty. It can be a local flap or it can be a Foley's pyloplasty or Davis intubated pyloplasty or Hellstrom's arterial relocation. There are special conditions which are present with hydronephrosis. Now in these special conditions, one need to be very careful while offering the treatment to the patient. Hydronephrosis with CRF, that is chronic renal failure. What will happen? In these patients, we need to first treat a chronic renal failure, stabilize the patient, and then go for surgery. Sometimes what we need to do, we have to do a drainage from the loin approach and actually relieve the pressure, stabilize the patient, and go for pyeloplasty. For non-functioning kidney, we need to do a renal scan. We assess the viability, how much we can salvage, and then we can take a function. We can take then a choice of either retaining the kidney or we can just remove the kidney, that we can do a nephrectomy rather than doing such surgeries for the patient. In severe infection, we need to first settle the infection or sepsis and then treat it accordingly. In a child, what we do a simple pyeloplasty and we don't remove the kidney. Again, we treat the infection. In a child, growth factor or growth hormone is considered as a renotrophic factor. So it helps in building the kidney very nicely. So we try to salvage as much as possible. And in an ectopic kidney, it has to be very specific. Unless patient is symptomatic or with some complications, then only we offer some radical treatment. Otherwise, the main aim is a nephron sparing or kidney salvage surgery. So in hydronephrosis, what we have seen so far is the etiology, basic changes in the pathophysiology, typical clinical features, what options we can offer, basic investigations, and the best possible modality of treatment for the patient. Thank you.